You're watching The Breakfast Club.
Morning, everybody. It's DJ MV Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God. We are The Breakfast Club. We got some special guests in the building.
For sure.
We have the cast of Power. We got Ghost, Angie, Tasha, and Tommy.
And that's how I know I'm invested in the show, because that's who I see when they walk in the
room. That's how I know.
I don't see Omari. That's not our real names. I don't see Tori. I don't see Joseph. I don't see Leela.
That's their real name.
Word up. Ghost, Tommy, Tasha, and Angie.
There you go.
Yeah. That's who I see.
Now, it comes back this Sunday, July 17th. You
it
guys
sure
moved
does.
To Sunday now.
Yep. Yes.
Why they push it to Sunday?
Yeah. That was a graduation.
That's Sunday is a big day.
That's like big boy.
Sort of we like Thursdays is for comedy, Sundays for drama, particularly cable drama. Mm-hmm. You know, that way people can have their Saturday nights.
Get your Saturday
go to church
Batman
and then
party.
Watch Power.
Now, Charlamagne, you got to ask some of these questions because I've seen the first episode and I don't want to spoil it.
Yo.
So I'll let you leave with some of these.
I haven't seen the first episode.
I know, that's what I'm going to let you ask. You asked about it.
I mean, I can't wait to watch season two, first of all, because I want to know how the hell
Kanan.
Season three, my bad.
Yes, yes, yes.
I want to know how the hell Kanan got out that room.
I'm still asking.
I know, that's,
I
don't, like, that that's looked, a good
that,
question.
Because that could even make the show, that could make the season real corny.
Because I dropped the match right there, right?
Yeah.
Burned him up.
I know. He's hard to kill.
I feel like that's a shout out to Dynasty.
Yeah, it was a Dynasty moment. I mean, I don't know. You know, it's one of those things where we got so much social media coverage after that. Like, yo, this is bull. I thought it was truthful until this moment.
Exactly.
Mm.
But then people forget. As you said, we walked in and you made us the characters that we are, but everybody forgets he's also the executive producer, so that might have something to do.
That's funny.
Don't really understand in the first episode as well either, so that's a good thing.
Oh, so they don't explain how he really got out that room.
He might or he might not be in the first episode.
So this is the point in time where I got to realize Power is just a TV show.
It's just a
TV
show.
You might have to let go of the idea this is real life.
Now, Ghost, are you leaving the game?
He trying.
Is it over
for
you?
Yeah, when the tagline is Ghost Must Die, I don't know, man.
Are you leaving the game? Is the game over for you?
Mm. I think it's hard to take the game out of the cat. Mm-hmm. You can take the cat out of the game a little bit, but he and Tommy grew up with Kanan's help at figuring out how to distribute these drugs throughout all of New York, and so I don't really know how much I can leave the game. Problem is, Jamie's skill set doesn't match what Ghost needs. Mm. And all of these people hunting or coming after Ghost, like, Jamie can't really contend with that. He's just this love-sick puppy who wants, you know, to leave, should I say Tasha or Notori?
Tasha.
You, Charlamagne.
Don't confuse the audience.
I'm going to say Tasha.
No,
right.
Yes, yeah. Tasha.
So he's just, you know, he wants
he's
to leave
to
Tasha.
Leave
he don't want to leave the kids. He don't want to leave Tommy. Mm. But he wants Angela. He feels like he can find a safe haven with her. He can hide up at least in Angela's world.
Right.
But the problem is her world is like the enemy. She's become like, she's sleeping with the enemy for both of them.
So you done with your baby mama?
I'm not the baby mama. I'm a wife. Thank you, Charlamagne. You know?
I'm sorry.
I don't expect nothing good to happen to you because you left your wife with the side chick. Nothing good comes to guys who do that.
You know that.
And I'm sticking to that story because that's what I say every weekend when I'm watching it with my wife. Like, that guy is wrong.
Yeah.
What he's doing is wrong.
And then what about when your wife goes to the bathroom?
I'm like, damn, Angela, bad. I can see why. I can see why.
I can see you. That's good.
Show you right.
No,
Now, Angela, you have a problem playing that character because you are the side chick, and now people might look at you.
No, I don't have a problem playing the character at all. I have a problem with, like, people's crazy coming at me.
Oh, they think you're the side chick in real life?
For real.
Oh, yeah, there's a lot. Like, whenever you're sexualized as a character, it inevitably transfers from you, the character, to you, the actress. And, like, the truth is I'd rather, like, drink milkshakes and, like, fart under the covers at night than...
Did you say fart under the covers?
I sure did.
You are nasty.
We don't want to hear that. Now, we got fantasies about you. Now, I like sucking farts out of
girls'
butts.
Oh, my gosh.
You know,
really?
Yeah. This is like...
I don't want it to be milkshake-driven. Like, you know what I'm saying?
How
like, I want a natural, organic fart, maybe from some vegetables.
Nasty fart.
Yeah, it was okay. Listen, she was drinking organic milkshakes.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
It smells like vanilla beans.
And no pun intended.
Yeah,
I'm going to ruin the fantasy for you.
Yeah.
I can't help it. Now, if you have a little fantasy about me, I'll just destroy it.
It's over now.
It's over.
So do guys walk up to you and be like, yo, would you be my side chick?
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, they do.
You know, I get some interesting pictures on social media sometimes.
That you try to show me.
They send you penis pics.
You should be trying to show me that. DJ,
wow. You know, I got one guy that's harassing the hell out of me. He creates a new Snapchat every day, and he sends me penis pics.
He sends you penis pics?
Every day he's trying to holler at me, be like, yo, you look fly in those jeans today.
Damn.
And he ain't block him yet, by the way.
I be blocking him.
Think about that. Think about that. Every day.
Block him every day.
This is crazy.
Do you get crazy sent to you?
No, because not on social media. People actually just catch me in the street.
and show you their
I mean,
penis?
I get no, that too. No, no. Not, this is not about penises, people. No, I mean, I live in New York. I live in Brooklyn. People are really, I get a lot of love, honestly, but it's more women.
Look at you.
It's more, but it's like inappropriate from guys because they think I'm actually like having sex with Amari, his character. They want to try all the positions we try. It gets really weird. But most of it is just women. Like, just like, yeah, I'm Team Tasha. I'm ready for you. And, you know, they want to control the story. They're very passionate.
Because a lot of women can relate. Because women hate side chicks. They do not like a woman interfering on
them.
Well,
and it's just more of the story in general. They really, less than just a side chick, I think people really appreciate that Tasha's a ride or die for her husband, her children. She's the woman that you kind of want to have on your side. If you about to go down, she's going to really, you know,
it's interesting,
hold you
though, because the storyline like isn't clean. Drugs, it's not.
That's
it's,
the only part that Tasha
clean,
doesn't
like,
get.
In terms of like the wife isn't like perfectly
perfect.
A wife.
Yeah.
And then at
she
the same
perfect
time.
To me. Until you came along,
I
ruining
know.
It.
She masturbated in the first scene.
I did.
And she also doesn't uphold the vision scene. Of
but
a
hey,
man.
I had to get out my frustration.
That was very natural.
There was there's places where you're rationalized and the places that you don't, right? And so that doesn't make any sense ultimately. Like, none of the characters on Power are clean.
Are perfect.
Mm-hmm. So when people like will like condemn one with a fervor and like defend another with a lot of passion, like ultimately that tells on
it tells
the person.
Oh, no, that's true, because I called Tasha all kind of hoe bitches when she masturbated in that car in front of that driver. I'm like,
did
see, now that's
really?
Some hoe stuff. Now that ain't what she's supposed to do.
You know what?
See, that's why
I
wives lose their
bet.
Husbands right there because of her trying to get back. You got to be better than us.
But if
she's
you was
the
driver, you would have been cool with it.
I'd have loved it.
See?
But that's why Sean dead now too. True.
So he went down for the cause.
Charlamagne the God's still here. Sean
I know.
Dead.
I know.
Now, Tommy and Ghost, y'all don't see eye to eye in the first episode. It looks like y'all not seeing eye to eye.
No.
Tommy, you trying to start
that's
your own?
That's an understatement.
Yeah, you're trying to start your own situation and operation.
Well, I think the situation, the operation. I think that Tommy, through this journey of season three, well, he has to either sink or swim, and I think that we all know that, you know, he's gonna live, you know, as much as he can, and then he's gotta make this organization work. But I think that once the veil gets removed, he will see how much work he's already been doing by himself anyway, because Ghost has removed himself from the game wisely enough, not saying, hey, Tommy, look at everything you did. Tommy, look at how amazing you've done in the game. He told Tommy, yeah, you're good, but I'm better. And yet he hasn't been doing anything. So once Tommy realizes, I think the fun for me is when Tommy actually realizes, wow, I've been doing this by myself for a long time.
There was a moment in this, I guess the finale, when I turn to Joe's character and I say, he says, yo, this is the only thing I've ever been good at in season two. And I go, nah, fuck that, you're great at it. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And it was an ad lib. It wasn't in the script. And what's ironic about it is the writers have done a great job. If we ad lib, they sort of allow that to go to,
right,
you know, a new direction. And so you actually see him on a steroid level in season three to me. So Joe's going to get even more fanfare this year because it's a coming out party for Tommy.
Now you see, but I don't see where y'all go from here, though. And that's the thing about Power, so many twists and turns, because it's like, that's your best friend. Now your best friend trying to kill you.
Exactly.
Do y'all ever reconcile later
on? You
got on
to. You know the thing about it? That's a great question. The thing about it, Charlamagne, is when you think about our agenda versus the fair agenda, as smart as they are, as bright as women are, as much as they say, watch out for that, we go stand in and go, sorry, I had to stand in it to understand what you meant.
Yeah.
We make up. We figure things out. Our battles become reconciled a lot easier than when girls are battling.
After somebody trying to kill you, though?
I don't know.
But
when they're
best
with
friends,
that.
You can't. You
I feel
can't,
like
generally
I agree
speaking,
with him.
Absolutely.
Men are just.
Absolutely.
It's so much different.
So different. But the reality is, for them to be best friends and brothers, in essence, you've had at points in life, I mean, we watch all of the, we raised on the mafia films, and you see, literally, they took Fredo out. I mean, Michael Corleone's character takes Fredo out and gets him taken out, and he's done.
Yeah.
That's his brother.
Yeah.
So it's not that non-truthful in a game of drug dealing and selling. Mm. Paranoia becomes a big thing, and people forget, Tommy's freaking doing the product. He's doing drugs.
Mm. So really, you're supposed to Nino Brown and G-Money him. You're supposed to kill him.
There you go.
I mean,
well,
probably.
He also has
you know,
the charge
but I am
of
my
Lobos
brother's keeper in some ways.
You.
Am I going
to
do it? You know what I mean? Like, how much is the struggle? How much of the struggle is real in Tommy? How much is he figuring out? And how much have we always seen people underestimating Tommy's savvy and Tommy's intelligence? I mean, time and again it happens.
It's true. Mm-hmm. And to Lila's point, Lobos is giving you the command to do Ghost in, but Lobos can't matter to. That's the point of your point. Lobos can't, in my opinion, if it's truthful, Lobos can't matter more to him than a 25-year relationship.
Yeah.
But if you're on drugs, you know, who knows where Tommy's at? He's also addicted to Holly. He's got that whole other thing. I mean, she's crazy.
She kind of trash too, bro. You can do she's a little crazy. Better than Holly, oh. bro.
Yeah, well, you know, love is blind.
Hey.
Well, in the first episode, there's a twist with that. But also, do you think your penis game is so strong that Ange won't turn on you? Because she works for the government.
It's not about the penis game. No, it's not the penis not game. Understanding it.
Yeah.
That Platinos love hard, though, man.
I know, huh?
You know, Lila
has said before in interviews, and I think it's true, she says she cut off a piece of her when she left at 15 years old and left the neighborhood and did all of that. And so he not only sort of bridges what she missed in terms of the neighborhood guy that she believed could have been better, but also giving her some intimacy that otherwise Greg doesn't allow. She just basically F's Greg. Mm-hmm. She goes to work. She dominates work. And then when it comes to Andy Bean's character, who's doing a brilliant job playing Greg Knox,
fantastic.
She basically uses him like she's using everybody to get her wins, her victories. Mm-hmm. She's got her own ghost going on. So there's an innate attraction that the two of them have, but I don't think it would minimize the power that Courtney Kemp has written these female characters to have if it was just about the dick game. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but Greg, for a lot of women, it is about that.
But I think
it's not a fair comparison.
It's not the same. I mean, Ghost is.
Let's call it spade a spade on that.
You're right.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. And Ghost and Danger is attractive. You know, Andy Bean's character eventually goes to the wrong levels of danger. He's stalking her. He's behind a trash can.
Yeah.
Because he knows she's cheating with a black man.
I don't know that.
He's the bad guy. It's not that he's just the bad guy.
He knows that he's cheating with a bad guy.
With the bad guy that they're trying to put in jail. He knows that he's Ghost and believes that Angela is down to protect him. It's a whole thing.
Wait,
let's
go back to Holly for a second.
By Lucy Walters.
Lucy Walters is amazing, and I'm going to let Joe speak to this, but like, it's not that Holly's trash. It's that she accepts Tommy entirely for who he is.
Also, for Tommy, I mean, I always thought that Holly's probably exotic to him in some capacity.
I mean,
she's a white girl. I mean, I think, in my mind, Tommy was, you know,
like
black
sisters.
Women.
Oh, yeah,
his whole life. And especially black women with red hair, like, okay, now we're getting somewhere, you know, with his weird mom complex. But then, like, I think that Holly, in some capacity, hey, here's this club. Tommy's not the guy that's going to clubs. And then he sees this, oh, wow. I always felt like she's exotic.
It's a great scene.
She's like, yeah.
It's a great scene.
When when he first sees her, yo, you see me now?
Well, yeah, not but only that, Holly but stole my earrings.
I thought she was trash when she stole your earrings.
We're Tommy and Tasha, you know, for me, I was just so hurt that he would defend this random, you know, woman over his sister. I mean, when Holly steals her earrings, it shows me she can't be trusted, and he values my opinion. He values the advice that Tasha has. So it's almost like that's a brokenness between the sibling relationship, and that's kind of why I don't trust her.
To Notori's point, I believe, I didn't mean to cut you off, Al, but I just wanted to add, Notori's character, what I love about her Lady Macbeth character is that it's all calculated. Mm-hmm. So her desire for Ghost to remain Ghost and never to be James or Jamie is from a calculated perspective. It's very well thought out.
She's really smart.
She's smart. Holly, to Leela's point, Holly does want Joe's character to remain exactly Tommy.
Sniff the coke, kill people.
Exactly that. Which somebody could compare it to and say, well, Holly and Tasha are actually similar. Because they both want their men to be marginalized to just that thing they see.
That's
but the difference is Holly's not necessarily bright.
Yeah.
And that's an understatement.
And she's grimy.
She kind of brings him down.
She's actually not
like,
smart at all.
Like, I don't want to tell Tommy, but I feel like she's going to bring him
but
down.
But here's the funny thing that you think.
Which
like
is crazy,
because
Lucy's so bright.
When she stole the earrings, like, that was done. Mm-hmm. She's trash. In the world of power, that is like a misdemeanor when people are, like,
oh,
murdering
people. That's true.
There's way worse things that could
go wrong. Tommy brought her into the circle, brought her to the crib.
This is the fame.
And she stole.
I fed her.
Yeah, what about the circle of trust where they leave Tommy out of the fact that they killed Kanan?
Well, you know, some things are circumstantial.
Not kill Kanan, put him
to
in.
Protect.
Yep.
You know, I think everything is circumstantial.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Is like none of the characters are clean. Like it's really hard to argue.
Yeah,
really hard
no,
one
true.
Position.
It's
no, that's true. It's true.
Now, in the season premiere, you know, when they introduced the show, they talked about that at first. they were kind of, I guess the writers and the people behind the scenes was kind of wary about you and really wasn't 100% with you. How does that make you feel acting now and being successful? Do you go back and flip the bird, get the middle finger, ask for more money?
From what I heard, all the writers the were 100% on board. I think it was the executives. The executives of a network that was not in the position it is now because of Omari Hardwick.
Was,
they were in a different position than they are now. And Power was not the number one show on the number two premium cable network. It was like the number four premium cable network, and Power didn't exist yet. So yeah, they probably had some question because they had a lot riding on this more than they would ever let us in on. And then this is what happened.
Who did more, Michael Jai White? I have a friend. You and Michael Jai White look like y'all came off the same gremlin.
You know what? You are hilarious. He's so silly.
He crazy.
But they now better recognize.
You know what happened? You know what happened was, and actors, you know, listening, they should all hear this. Mm-hmm. I was privy to the champions of these three, meaning that everybody wasn't on board with them. You know what I mean? You'd have five people
There's
that wanted Naturi.
Right.
You'd have six that wanted Joe, but then three didn't, and Lila was the same way. So we forget about, because what happens is when you guys humble us with like the reception of the show, and you go, I can't picture a different Tommy,
right.
a different Tasha, a different Angie,
Absolutely.
A different Ghost. Mm-hmm. Then your mindset, to Joe's great point, doesn't go back to pre-production of like, let me think. Omari's good. This is what execs thought. He's a good actor, but up to this point, we've just seen him perhaps steal scenes. Mm. He hasn't necessarily been a lead yet. People have always wondered about him. It's a freaking 10-year career at that point. Why hasn't he da-da-da-da-da?
Gotcha.
But in the midst of the race relations conversation that we're having every single day, we got to remember, there's not a lot of Omaris in a position to play a character like Ghost prior. Shonda Rhimes, hats off, had done certain things with Isaiah Washington. Mm-hmm. You know, she's done obviously other things with Columbus Short. We've seen black men. Omar Epps has played on House at one point. Mm-hmm. I played on shows where I was number two on the call sheet. Denzel all the way back to St. Elsewhere and beyond. But nobody's necessarily played a complicated, crazy, brilliant, range-filled character as bountiful as Ghost. And all those colors made the
who
likes
really
at stars go, I don't
you
really know if he can pull it off.
Right. She just said you had a great ass.
Yeah, no.
At the end of the day, what happened in terms of flipping up the bird, because I think that's a good question, I poured it all into Naturi, Lila, and Joe.
Yeah.
They knew that I came in with that angst. Gotcha. And I was like, I got to prove something. And they aided in that. The three of them knew prior that was going on. 50
yeah,
knew as well.
Yeah, I remember.
We all got together and we said, let's prove together. Let's prove everybody that you're exactly where you're supposed to be. And anybody that was a naysayer about Naturi or Joe or Lila, nobody's like that anymore. The four of us
motivation.
Are now talking to YouTube.
I've had naysayers my whole career.
Some people didn't know
Lila
at all.
I mean, naysayers is like part of the hustle.
I mean, me personally, I only knew Naturi and Omari. I didn't know.
I mean,
racist,
and that's the thing.
So, I get it. But you know, it's another thing. Just to real quick, give a shout out to Chris Albrecht. I mean, also the green light behind shows like The Wire and The Sopranos. Also greenlit Power. Mm. And he's the one who from the network, who also was probably negotiating where everybody fit in this system. And he ultimately allowed this show to go with the trust and the belief in Courtney A. Kemp and Curtis 50 Cent Jackson, and then Omari Hardwick at the helm. And you know, now we're going into season three, and I'm quite certain we'll go beyond.
But for all the naysayers, now what? I just
want
to say, for all the bottled up frustration, now what?
You turned Lil' Kim just now.
But
you know what's ironic about it?
It's like,
and that was humbling to hear from Charlamagne. Just for you to even say, I knew Omari and Naturi. What's humbling about it is the same guy that is very close to all four of us, and that being Chris Albrecht. He did put HBO on the map.
Yeah.
He absolutely did. Mm-hmm. But ironically, he questioned whether Omari not necessarily could act, but he questioned if I could literally be the face of a show and be what James Gandolfini, rest in peace, was to Tony Soprano.
Gotcha.
Ironically, the same man that questioned that thought that Joe was perfect for Tommy. Mm. So you can have in the
With
same mindset
people,
somebody
yeah.
go,
"You,
Tommy, Joe is it. Is Omari it?"
Gotcha.
And then y'all end up getting Tommy and Ghost together and going, how could two people... Gotcha. Be less cohesive. How
and
could that work?
I mean, I don't ever look at naysayers as necessarily bad because of their thing. I always prefer to be in the underdog position and come up from behind.
Now,
hold on. Lila said, that Omari had a great ass, right? I wonder how that works, because y'all do a lot of sex scenes and stuff, and Omari, you a married
well,
man.
Well, the reason why I'm saying that is actually because, like, he's then she the said only underdog man's and I've coming ever up from behind. By other heterosexual ooh. Men.
Damn, Ace Boy.
I know it all.
Why I'm saying that is because, like, he's the only man's ass that I've ever heard discussed by other heterosexual men. You'll hear, like, dudes.
I don't know if we should call yeah, those men out. Like, should we call them out?
Beer. Yeah, they're probably the same dudes that are asking envy for a penis.
Right?
It's the same man.
We should watch out for those penis pics.
Ain't no straight men. Let's keep ain't it collected. No straight
men drinking like, no beer
talking about but the bar.
Exactly.
But to your point, the sex scenes are crazy in our show.
I thought y'all called that out better than us.
No. But to Charlamagne's point, the you know, and what Lila's saying about our sex scenes, of course we all have. I mean, she's got a great body. Look at Joe. He's killing it. I mean, Omari, I don't know. I'm doing what I can. But at the end of the
you
day.
You look great, body.
You look great. Look great.
Don't thank you. Don't go there, Charlamagne. I got to watch you. I got to watch you. The dive of chocolate. You're so sweet. No, but at the end of the day, the sex is used in a really cool way. Like, Power is so well written that even the sex scenes have a story. Even the sex scenes have intention.
Courtney Kemp, our creator,
Courtney
done
Kemp,
an incredible
yes,
job of that.
Thank yeah. you. And she creates these moments where Ghost is in dealing with frustration of his day or killing someone or taking his frustration out on Angela or him and Holly or even me. The sex is intentional. It's smart. It's done in a way that's not gratuitous. I'm really proud of
you know
her.
What how do you know real life partners
I
deal with that?
Well, you know though. What I was going to ask you? See, it's funny, Charlamagne.
Because she just said you had a great ass. Nah, your wife at home like, yo, now look now.
She's like, yeah, I love Lila.
You know what I was
going to say?
But I never got to ask anybody this. I want to know, because everybody talks about how many couples watch it together.
Right.
Yeah. We were just.
Does it? Is it nice foreplay to watch us do
absolutely.
That?
Absolutely. After the premiere,
I never have asked that.
My wife and, like, it depends, you man. On the desk, you
word. Her,
and Angie did it. Angie was like, I don't want this position. I'm turning around.
I can't.
I'm sorry. I'm
that's
up too much.
I can't.
No, but what? Have you ever thought about it? Think about it.
This is TMI.
Think about
once,
it.
Once your no, wife gets, you, once your wife de-escalates from being upset that you're cheating on your wife,
yeah, right.
so
okay.
blatantly.
Oh, so then they accept that.
Yeah.
So then they won. Yeah.
You'd be like, I'm gonna knock you like Omari did Ange, turn around.
On the desk.
So it's kind of
man,
episode one.
Do you got a man
oh,
in real
oh,
life?
Oh, hell no, not right now.
She said hell.
See,
no,
and
no,
that's
no.
the thing. It's you hard. Married,
you didn't
she's
look
single.
At Charlamagne in eyes when you said that.
Mm-hmm. You don't have a man.
No.
You married, she's single, she said you had a
his
great
wife
ass.
Knows
does your wife
swim?
Get upset about stuff like that?
Naturi and Elle have been great sisters to her, so they all figure it out.
Yeah.
They all figure
we're
it out.
We're all in.
She's
I
a
mean,
tough chick.
Different stages of life, chick. But security is part of it, you know?
It's necessary, man.
Joe has a beautiful wife, and yeah. he's having lots of sex this season, so look out.
I mean, radio's funny because from as long as Donnie Simpson was doing it and beyond, right?
Donnie Simpson, the OG, salute to him.
As long as he was doing it, you always say, I mean, Joe's from Chicago, Tori from Jersey.
Shout out to Jersey.
Omari's from ATL. Lila's from
Sacramento.
Upstate. I say upstate Bay Area. Upstate.
No,
upstate
it's not the Bay Area. It's the Valley.
It's the valley of the Bay Area. So radio was so big to all of us, if you think about the different regions that we come from. Mm-hmm. But in reality, you guys always hear, you and Envy always hear, oh, a face for radio. But come on.
That's true.
But come on. You and Envy happen to be handsome men, and you're doing radio. You don't have your wives at some point going,
dick
are you staying out too late?
But they ain't having sex on TV. Are
you Omari calling
but
me
handsome?
Wait, but do you
yeah. got a nice ass, brother. Since you can
why is this is too much.
Since we're trading
compliments.
We're not scared.
Male flirt.
Not scared at the Breakfast Club.
But you know what happens, Charlamagne. If you and Envy stay out late at some you know your wives are like, you got to go to that.
Yeah.
You got
no, it's real. That's real.
So you got to bring them around to make them feel comfortable.
Exactly.
They want to meet them. Let me meet Lila. Let me meet Natori. Yeah.
That's what
they
I do.
They met halfway.
My boyfriend knows, like, everybody knows each
close.
Other.
We're
all
close.
All close. So we hang
it's
out.
It's weird. I know we're
it's
killing fans
respect.
Right now. Fans are so
yeah,
mad
I'm
at
sorry.
Us right now.
Well, yeah. So that's that. But yeah.
Is it true Power has a nudity clause? That somebody has to appear nude at some point during the run of the show?
Well, no, it's in your contract.
It's their option. Yeah.
Really?
The network has the option. The network has the option. You don't have to.
Yeah, I mean, that's like, you know our contract.
You know y'all had leaks and all kind of stuff.
You know, because they be hacking it.
You know they hacked Naturi's email.
They did. I think Charlamagne knows that pretty well. I don't know nothing about nothing.
I don't know nothing.
They tried to. Yes.
And then they were hollering. And then apparently, because Curtis called me.
I didn't say
no, no, no.
Curtis called me, 50 called me and
was
like,
crazy.
Yo, they hacked Naturi, change it. I didn't change it, but she was the only one that got.
And
got.
I actually everybody was talking with the feds. How ironic!
Right.
I was talking to Angela's people.
Totally independently.
I mean, hacked to the point where they tried to steal the scripts and sell them. Scripts. That's like the craziest thing I've ever heard
that's
of.
That's successful.
You'd have been better off trying to sell your pictures naked. That was a better.
That just feels like a really bad business plan.
It's not a good idea. He actually got caught.
We have to. I guess Joe was going to speak on it. We do have to be open.
Yeah, it's the option. It's, you know, it's a nudity option
clause.
Yeah, there
is a nudity
clause. Might see with Timmy.
They have the option of requesting you be naked, and you can't just say, no, I won't be.
You
know what you're getting into.
How do you know this?
So you might see Timmy's character graduate this year, Dre, to, I don't know. The four of us feel like the sex trophy has to be passed.
Passed on. I was season one. We were season one.
I've been on Lucy,
three seasons.
Like,
yeah.
I'm ready to be
retired. He had a threesome.
Yeah. I'm passing it.
Now, with everything going on in the African-American community, is that put into the show at all? Because you see that every once in a while that a show will take something out of real life and put it. Do we see that at all?
I see, Lila, you've been vocal.
Definitely.
Yeah, I see Black Lives Matter.
Yeah, absolutely. I feel like I can't wait. Yeah, well, to your question, and then, Lila, you can speak on it, too. I think Courtney is going to probably add more.
She'll
and that's one of the things
right.
that
her,
coming up
will.
In season four, if there will be a season four, it will be discussed. So I think we're all, you know, we talk about it amongst each other. I'm really upset.
I went on Huffington Post yesterday.
Marching. It's frustrating. Mm-hmm. And we all talk about how this Black Lives Matter is just about more so making sure the nation understands why our lives matter mm-hmm. and why we're being ignored and not put in a position of feeling valuable in America. It's frustrating.
We made, you know, Joe made a really good point yesterday. That's a good point, Notori. Joe said yesterday, and I didn't think about it, he said, we're kind of subtly doing our job in this show by even having the diversity of cast that we have.
Mm-hmm.
So if conversations are needed within the community, I said it yesterday on Black Voices on Huffington Post, my thought was, everybody keeps talking about conversations are needed between policymakers, between mm-hmm. politicians, but the reality is the conversations are needed between the young men, mm-hmm. sometimes literally the young men, but hopefully at least a representative of the young man that's being basically hunted in the streets.
Yeah.
Between the policymaker, between someone that works for Congress, between cops, to sit down with the kid that they're afraid to actually say out loud that
mm-hmm.
they fear.
That they're afraid of us.
They're actually afraid to say that they're afraid of us.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So for a kid to be thought of in a particular way because his pants are sagging or because he's splitting verbs and not articulating the way that they expect us to speak.
And sometimes right. you don't even have to do anything.
The reality of life is you can't necessarily diminish, and we would be remiss if we didn't, you know, champion Joe's point that at least we are of a diverse conversation. Mm-hmm. New York happens to be the backdrop of that. It's probably on the call sheet because it's so diverse as a city, but in terms of like the cops pulling over Black while driving, ironically, Joe's character, the bad character, played by a Polish American man, last year he was pulled over. Mm-hmm. Yo, driving while Black. But we embrace it because of what Tommy has grown up in. Mm-hmm. But to really go there, I guess to Notori's point, knowing that Courtney is as bright as she is, we'd have to piggyback it off of Tariq, played by Michael Rainey Jr., mm-hmm. who is exactly the age of these kids.
Yeah.
He's in that. So I don't really know if we can go six or seven seasons if we're lucky and not address this in some capacity.
Now, whose idea was
Lila,
it?
Lila said she actually posted Black Lives Matter.
Yeah, and I posted it in the context of articles because, you know, there are models of police departments mm-hmm. that have been bad and have turned things around. NPR did this really great piece of journalism called Cops See Things Differently, and it took 2 hours. The first episode was really useful to really have cops candidly speak about their mindset because so many of them feel that how can we be having an issue if so much of the time we're intervening between Black-on-Black violence?
Yeah.
And then the second part of the issue is getting into the hard numbers and the gap between we, the public, seeing a video versus how they see the video and how there's this huge disconnect between us watching the same thing and us feeling that two different things are happening. And then they did an example of a police department going incredibly awry and of them just basically abusing the community to fulfill quotas and like kind of just
LAPD.
Yeah, oppressing low-hanging fruit that couldn't defend for themselves. And then the second part of the article was actually really inspiring It started discussing something called racial bias. We have all these implicit biases, like why do you like Toyota better than Ford? Well, that also bleeds out to race, where
absolutely.
There's a lot of cops that don't consciously feel like they're racist. That's why they fight it so much.
Right.
But that's still not taking into consideration implicit bias. And they've done a series of studies. And the interesting thing is that when you flash images, all people, including black men, have a higher rate of seeing black men as a threat. And when
they
it comes
including black men?
Yes, including
absolutely.
Black men.
Well, you know what's interesting?
And, I can see that.
Well, let me finish this really quick.
But the black cop, they talked about that on NPR as well. And I've always wanted to do a documentary interviewing what black cops feel.
Well, and it's
about.
But it's the, like
yeah,
because
they can't
also,
stand up. They don't stand up and speak out against the negativity that's going on in their
right.
own.
But it's also
force.
This thing of like if you're in a series, it's almost like PTSD, where if you're in a series of negative experiences, you start developing these unconscious biases, and that really comes into play when you're holding a gun and why something escalates and you react. Because people are like, well, maybe they'll think about it more. And a lot of times when someone's capping someone, they're not thinking, they're reacting.
Oh,
and
oh.
so the departments that have turned it around have used training programs to help people really balance those biases and to kind of train them with those biases in place, like knowing that's going to happen, or other programs where like they make the police community also have positive associations with the black community, mm-hmm. you know, where they're playing basketball so that you get a balance of attention.
Yeah.
And I just, that's as much as I can speak to it. I don't know. Like, I just sort of look, the best way that I can be an ally is to disseminate information and to also have like calm conversations with the people who see things differently.
And sleep with black men. Now, Joe, let me ask
so
you a question.
Silly.
Yeah.
Right? What do you think, say to people who say that art influences kids to act negatively? So like a show like Power.
That's a great question.
Yeah, I think it can go both ways. I think that if people are actually having conversations, I think that a show like Power would I think ultimately lead to a positive conversations and discussing actions that have consequences. Mm-hmm. And this obviously isn't a very fruitful way of getting out of the hood. But, you know, somebody like 50, like, you know, who was put into negative situations that where he had to make choices that brought him to a certain level to allow him to change his life into, you know, an incredibly successful businessman is probably a better way to go.
And,
so it's like
now producer.
Yeah, now producer of a successful television show, his first of many, I'm sure. And then to go back and say, well, see this example that made this, if you actually go back, I think mm-hmm. it will be.
Yeah.
But I think that if people take it at, you know, kind of at face value, I think it could lead to people just saying, oh, this, I want to emulate this character that I see on here, and especially even to your point of walking in, like, you guys are those characters.
Yeah.
And like
we have to tell people.
Yeah, and the reality of it. So I think it can be backlash, but I think that there's nothing different than any other show that's ever been on that could do that. And I think that to speak to what Omari said, that really just the diversity of cast and seeing a white guy in what we typically would put a African-American male in that position, I think is important, just even in terms of conversation and in terms of people's, like Lila was saying, visually,
the
you
visual
see this
bias.
Into
which
this.
Makes,
and
the show is so smart. So that's why I love what Power does. And I think that's why the community and all people have connected to our show. I think that's why we're the number one show on Starz. I think that's why we've been able to build up the network.
In Starz
I think
history.
That's, yeah, in Starz history. Starz thank history. You. But it's unbelievable when you see the unexpected. You don't expect Tommy to look like Joe initially, maybe on paper, the words and the way his swag. Tommy's got so much swag, they're like, damn, you know, all my friends want to date him. At the end of the day, it's changing the narrative and flipping the script.
But not only that, it's you guys are relatable. And this is what I was going to say. You guys move like a startup record label, meaning you guys are on the road. You're talking to kids in schools.
Oh, that's cool,
you're
man.
At the clubs.
Yeah, y'all together. I can't believe y'all together.
Startup label.
And I haven't seen
that
in a long
time. I love
that. That
takes me back.
Time,
I
mean,
that's
you know?
Yeah, that's how it used to be.
I seen y'all at Essence. I seen y'all.
That says a lot.
You know,
bro.
That
BET
shows a lot
experience.
Because people get to see you and say, damn, they are from where I'm from. They're
exactly.
from Sacramento, from New Jersey, from,
that's
you know,
what's
and people don't get to see
that's
that. And I respect
cool
that.
So who's your favorite group, Notori? Them or 3LW? Like, who would you rather be with? Who would you rather be with right now?
I'm moving with them all day, every day.
Thanks.
I would never go back. Definitely.
Never going back.
Never going back.
How close is the actual cast in real life, though? Like outside of the promo and
marketing.
Yeah, we're pretty cool.
I think people are shocked at how what good friends we are.
I see them a lot together. That's the crazy thing.
Whether even it's for press or even just, you know, the start of a season, getting together or going to the gym, or I ran into Joe actually because we live near each other at the gym or whatever it is, or they get smoothies, or I think there is something special about this power family.
Yeah, we genuinely like each other.
I genuinely don't think you get this in any other show. Like, I mean, people try to compare power to different things, but we are unique, and we are, you know, NBA, unique in our connection.
I knew Notori for about 8 years, and I always,
way back. Actually, when my first movie, Notorious, he came up to me and told me, you know,
But I remember when Leela and Notori and Joe came in, I kept thinking, and obviously you and Charlamagne work together, and you got all of these people around that work with you, but I always embraced what the Jew's perspective was in business. Mm-hmm. And particularly, specifically, the business of Hollywood and entertainment, and that was...
You might want to say Jewish people. Jewish people. Just in case.
Like, Jewish, let's take that back.
The Jewish community. I always thought it's really cool to have this concept, and it's a real play. 50 talks to me a lot about power and what it really is. And power is really being able to influence who gets hired and who you want to work with. And I always thought it was a really cool thing that... As I got older, I started thinking, you know what? Maybe the greatest people are not in necessarily the top positions next to an Adam Sandler, for example, I think is half Jewish. But the reality of life is, if he gets to work with the same people that we kept seeing in the early comedies in the 90s and 2000s, it's probably because he's like, I like working with him.
Right.
So look at Spike Lee.
So for me, I got lucky because I really liked Joe in the chemistry read. I really like Leela in the chemistry read, and I had already known and loved Notori. So my thought was, well, that part's cool. I don't need to really say that to the execs. Let that be my card that I hold safe to me, that I liked him. But then what was really dope was they were good. So if you're, that's ice. It should almost be icing on the cake. It should go the other way, where you really like working with somebody. Yeah. Now obviously they have to be adequate at what you've wanted them to bring to the table, but I just think it's a great perspective that we haven't necessarily figured out. A lot of times we want to support things that are not necessarily good or good for you. Mm. But if you got people that are next to you that are good for you,
lift them up.
Not only lift them up, it's counterintuitive to not freaking work with them. It's a short life, man. It goes around real quick. It ain't 9 lives.
We have really long hours.
Yeah. Our show is hard to shoot.
You know, so it helps like that we don't mind hanging out when we're off the set.
Wow,
it really does help.
No,
days. This is like 11-day an episode. Like she said, 16 hours.
We usually won the club scene 14, 18 hours.
Yeah,
man.
He came and hung with us.
Imagine
on
how tired the crew is.
You were on that episode.
The fight scene, Charlamagne.
When are you coming
me
back?
50,
come back and kick
10 hours.
With us.
You know, I got to talk to my manager.
Just
the
fight.
Yeah, see what
they have other things on that docket that they're getting in at the same location.
You know, they shoot long. That's why everybody's so mad. We empathize with everybody going, yo, why does it take so long to come back?
Yeah, sorry.
But in reality, to your point, Envy, we were a word of mouth thing versus the shows that would be compared to us.
That is a fact.
We were
word
hustle.
Of mouth. So we actually, our publicist now, Washington, is here. She can speak to it. We had to promote in a better, more constructive.
That's how we started. That's how the Breakfast Club started.
Y'all took it by storm.
We can't necessarily promote if the show is back so quick. Right. We need time to kind of.
That's a really good point. So
I started watching it on Twitter.
Did
because
you
I kept
real?
Seeing everybody talking about power. I'm like, what the hell is power? So by the time I started watching it, y'all was like 6 episodes into the first
season. To season one.
Yep.
Really?
Yep.
Well, I'm glad you caught
That's
up.
Good.
Well, it starts this Sunday.
No, one more question.
Sunday.
How hard is it for you to remain professional, Amari? Because you get sex scenes with Notori and Leela. Like,
you know
Leela,
what?
Do you ever feel them get hard?
The females
Stop
love
it.
Notori, do you ever feel them get
Stop.
Hard?
Like, here's the there thing.
It's like a big brother.
This is weird. Joe, still human.
I can't.
This is where people
it's
are.
No sexiness.
This is where people aren't understanding. Like, the hardest part about the sex scene is dealing with people seeing it afterwards and thinking it's real.
Gotcha.
First of all, this dude has a cock sock on that's so fucking tight.
Well, no.
Oh, you gotta wear. Okay, see, that's what I want to know. You gotta wear a cock sock.
We wear protection
as well. Like that. Like if he slept with that, it would castrate him like a bull. It would fall off his. Would fall off
it
and
hurts.
Die.
Mm.
And it is not, we, like,
it's
the fact
fun.
That we make it sexy, like, if you came in and watched, you'd be like, damn, they do a really
it's
good job.
It's like, and then sometimes things fall off.
It is
go
not
back,
ready.
I mean, after a while, you feel like, what?
It's like we're moving in weird positions.
Even though it's a small crew, there's still, like, 30 people.
I mean, yeah.
Wait, how many people?
30.
Still easily like, 30
yeah.
people watching.
Even if it's a close set, you still have people watching you, like, yeah, get it, Ghost. You know? Charlamagne, get it, Ghost.
There's sex scenes where the camera operator is
standing on the bed. While I'm saying, get it, Ghost, get it, Ghost.
Your wife like, are watching.
Yeah.
Y'all are watching from an angle that you're thinking he's on the bed while we're moving.
Yeah.
Like this.
Oh, that's good to know. So next time I don't have to be in that position. And that's impossible. That's that a camera trick. Okay.
So don't even worry. We're good.
Yeah. Gotcha.
But we're excited and grateful. I just want to say shout out to all the fans who've been with us, like you said, like a startup label.
Thank you, New York, man. Thank you, New York.
New York City.
Thank you, New York City.
The people who have been riding with us when we were a little bitty 8-episode show that nobody knew. Like, what's power?
Curtis said from day one.
It means a lot.
He said, this show is going to blow. And I'm like, damn.
Mind you, he told Olivia she was going to blow too. So let's not act like.
Don't say that.
Let's not act like.
Don't say that, Charlamagne.
I can't.
Don't say that.
I can't.
You know what
take
the worst
him.
Part of it is? Five is probably listening and laughing, but what's Olivia doing to that comment you just made?
Ooh. Wanting to guess the star on Power?
Power.
Yeah.
You know what?
Probably
does.
How do you control him?
Just let him go.
How many seasons y'all got written? Five already, right?
What'd you say? How many
were?
We didn't get the public announcement that season four is back, so it's not made official yet. But
so we're hopeful that the numbers are huge, so everybody should watch this Sunday at 9 p.m.
What I'm hoping is that when they bring back four, they actually make an announcement that four and five or that we got four and five.
So
that's what I'm putting out there. So we'll see.
Well, this Sunday, 9 p.m. on Star.
Sunday, be there.
Appreciate you guys for joining us.
Thank you so much.
The cast of Power is the Breakfast Club.
Breakfast. Peace.
The Breakfast Club, every weekday morning. Tune in.